All right, welcome to this hangout. Bruno Maag is with me, and he's the founder and president now, I think. Is that right, Bruno?
The chairman.
The chairman of Dalton Maag, which is one of the UK's top type design foundries. He gave a very interesting presentation at the BITS conference in Thailand a few weeks ago. And seeing some tweets about it, I asked him if he'd be willing to do a kind of hangout on air and go over the presentation so that everyone else can see it. He wasn't able to attend that awesome conference.
Okay, good, cool. Well, thank you very much. The whole presentation is really about type in a digital environment. It's not so much about type design, but it's more looking at a user perspective, you know, so what you as a user of typefaces really need to think about when you put type into a digital environment in particular. And of course, when I say digital environment, by and large, the print environment is included in this. It's typography and it's all encompassing. But I want to focus on a digital world, on a global world here. So let me share the screen with you, and then we can actually go and get ready with that presentation. Right, is that sharing?
I'm not seeing it yet.
Hang on, now we go, here we go. This should work now, yep.
Yes.
Cool, I
think. Perfect.
Perfect. Right, okay, now. Before I start off with a tirade about type and the usage of type in a digital environment, let me start with plankton. Now, plankton is, of course, the most abundant food source in the world. And it lives in the sea, and it comes in many shapes and varieties, you know, from a single cell structure all to a multi-cell organism, kind of like little crustaceans, as we can see in this most wonderful picture here. Plankton is not big enough to swim against tides, so it just floats around in the seas. And there's so much of it in there that it actually sustains all living beings on this planet. I mean, for example, if you go for a swim in the sea and by accident you gulp a bit of water, you will actually have had a full meal. That's what plankton is. It is absolutely important that we remember that, because you remove plankton from the planet, within days there will be no more life on Earth.
Yeah, that'll be the end.
It will be the end. So plankton, however insignificant we think it is probably one of the most vital ingredients on this planet. Yeah. So I just would like you to hold this thought for that, you know, for a little while, whilst we go through this presentation. So, but let's move into type, and the aesthetic stuff, of course, you know, matters a lot, you know, as much as plankton does. Jonathan Saunders is a British fashion designer, does lovely women's fashion. This is already quite a few years old, so spring, summer 2013, so it's not the most up-to-date collection, but some really lovely stuff. I have seen it live, you know, in real, his clothing. It's very beautifully done, very beautifully tailored, beautifully executed. But why, oh why, does this man have to have a logo like this? You know, I will never, ever buy a piece of a garment of this person simply because of this logo. Whilst the basic principle of the logo, the concept is good. It's high contrast. It conveys fashion. It conveys elegance. And you can see this across, you know, the entire fashion industry. If you think of Elle magazine or Vogue, they use high contrast typefaces. Other magazines, you know.
Yeah. And this doesn't have any serifs, which makes it a bit unusual.
Exactly. There's another magazine, it escapes me now, which is a sans serif too, but it is very thin. It's all very light and very thin typefaces. And that kind of style, you know, evokes elegance, a certain amount of authority as well, and classiness. But starting to look into the detail of the Jonathan Saunders. I mean, nothing fits. Absolutely nothing fits together here. Looking at the J and the O, for example. Either the J is too wide or the O is too narrow. I don't know. But when I look at the N, I would suggest that probably the O is too narrow compared to the other two characters. But that would then mean we would have to make all the other characters wider so that we would have a more even distribution of width. So anyway, there's something wrong there. And the J is pretty poorly executed anyhow. Then we look at the A. I mean, we have two diagonal thick strokes on the A. What is wrong with that? That is so not like you would expect, and actually what the design principle of a Latin A is. So if you think of the Latin characters, the way they were formed, and you think of the calligraphy, you have the broad pen nib, and it is held roughly at about 30 to 35 degrees angle. So as you pull the stroke upwards, so that's the left diagonal, you get a thin stroke, and as you pull it downwards, so that's the right diagonal, you get a thick stroke. So really you should have a thin upward and a thick downward stroke to get the right distribution of the weight in the A, the way we are used to seeing it, the way it has come from the tools. Now as we move along the characters, we come to the E, that lowercase e. Again, it is way too wide. And worst of all, the designer here of that logotype thought it would be clever to actually terminate all three horizontal strokes at exactly, mathematically, at exactly the same point. Now, visually, this results in the center bar looking too wide, the top bar being the second longest, and the bottom bar the shortest, when as a matter of fact, it should be exactly the opposite way. The bottom bar should be the longest, certainly mathematically, and then the center bar should be the shortest of them all. And if you want them to appear visually exactly to the same, you have to make optical adjustments exactly like that. As I said, the bottom bar the longest, the center bar the shortest, and it's just fractional amounts so that they visually align. In some typefaces, you obviously exaggerate the effect for aesthetic reasons. Now, I'm not going to go into the S. The S is a notoriously difficult character to do, even for type designers of long standing. They struggle with the S. It's so, despite its apparent simplicity, it's actually so complex to make the top and the bottom counter space balanced to one another, and to make sure that the S is stable and upright,
not leaning over.
Exactly, neither rolling left nor rolling right. So this is actually a very, very difficult thing to do. So we're not going to go into the S. However, at some point, after having met for many times, talked about this design, I decided it would be time that I actually do something about the logo. So I spent about an hour and a half and redrew the logo, kind of like evening out the widths a little bit so they harmonize better with one another, and get some of the typographic principles right so that the whole thing just gels together. Now, there's still some work to be done. I would say maybe another hour now, you know, or so, particularly on the spacing. There's some issues there. But I would hazard a guess, you know, that this is now just gelling together much better. It's more refined. Conceptually, it works better as well. I mean, for example, if we look at the O, we only have one thickness, and it's at the left. And that ties in with the H, it ties in with the D, it ties in with the U, and so on. So we have that rhythm going on. The E, obviously much more narrow, much more in keeping with the other letters, and just those slight visual adjustments done so that now the horizontal bars, you know, kind of visually align on the right-hand side. I did send this logo to the client, to Jonathan Saunders, to their marketing department, saying, guys, just use it. Don't have to pay me. Just use it so that you actually have a decent logo. Never heard back from them, and they're still not using it. They're still using their old poor logo. So maybe we can start a Twitter campaign or something. Public pressure for them to update their logo, because it really, every single time I look at it, it spoils my day. It spoils my weekend. You know, it really grates on me really badly. So Twitter. Here we come, power to the people. So, moving on a little bit, you know, we talked about the aesthetics, and we talked, you know, and we talk about details, and the detail matters. It's the devil is in the detail in typography. Slightly off and everything falls apart. And we worked on a little logo project recently for a Swiss kind of like high-end fruit juice producer, Michel. And they came to us and said they had this logo and they felt that something wasn't quite right, and they would, you know, wanted us to have a look at it and just kind of like make it happen. And if you look at the logo as it stands now, you can see, and this is the original that was supplied by the client, you can see that it was a bit of a hodgepodge of various typefaces coming together. Say, for example, compare the C with the E. You can see that the C is more like an italic typeface, whereas the E has much more handwritten feel about it. So the stresses in the curves are wrong and totally different. The weights are slightly different, and just the general treatment of the letter forms is different. If you look at the H and the L, the italic angles are slightly off as well from one another. The same with the C and the E, the italic angles, you know, are not quite right. The I leans a little bit more, the M leans a little bit more. So it's just kind of like a little bit of a hodgepodge, the whole thing, and just doesn't fit together. And it certainly doesn't convey a high quality product. So we did a number of iterations of detailed treatment of some of the various characters. But what we see now is the final version that was supplied to the client in the end, as I say, after some iterations. And we can see that we gelled it together. If you look at the C and the E again, they harmonize much more with one another. They actually feel as if they come from the same hand, from the same drawing. So and the stress in the curve, you know, it's applied exactly in the same way. The italic angles, you know, are even and consistent across all the letter forms. And at first glance, if you compare the two logo, you know, you probably don't see much of a difference. You know, really have to go into the detail. But when you actually put the two outlines on top of one another, you can see how much actually has changed. Not most notably, that the new logo is also a touch more condensed, making it tighter, making it just kind of like more of a unit. If I just go back a slide, just to look at it again, it's just more of a unit. It doesn't feel so sprawling. It holds together tight and nice now. Right, now. Detailing, extremely important. A project we did for Burberry, what you see here, we have the display typeface, which we designed for Burberry some years ago, and it is a high contrast typeface. Again, it's a fashion brand. High contrast typefaces means elegance, classiness, authority, that kind of stuff. And this typeface works really well in a display environment. The moment you go smaller with that, those serifs and those hairlines, those really thin lines, they will suffer. And this is when you have to start taking digital into consideration. As we can see, if I just go back again, you know, pixel grid, and you have these thin hairlines, how do you ever going to represent those on coarse and low resolution environments? Only once you get into higher resolutions you can actually represent those hairlines a little bit better, only at large sizes at that. So therefore, different versions of the logo and of the entire typefaces had to be designed. The top version, the display version with the very high contrast for sizes 18 point and above, and we're talking about paper, not about digital, 18 point and above. Then the middle version is slightly heavier size, slightly heavier hairlines from about 9 point onwards to 18 point, 20 point. And then we have a super small size version for everything below 9 point, 8 point. And this actually holds up. The small, the medium size and the super small size version can easily be used in a digital environment, and it will work even in lower resolutions as well.
And the spacing difference of that smallest one is very dramatic.
Exactly, because it is so super small. You can see the proportions are much wider as well. You know, all the characters have just slightly been increased in their width. And and as you say, Dave, you know, the spacing has been opened up quite dramatically to accommodate the small size, to make sure that we have enough white space so that there is, in a digital environment, there is no bleeding into the characters, into one another either. you know, so we can actually maintain typographic consistency, and we can maintain typographic quality, you know, and integrity of this logo. So what this really looks in detail, we can see here with the black outline being the original display version, and the red, of course, being the reworked version for the super small sizes. What you see here is in the red version, what's interesting is that obviously the thin lines, the hair lines, have gained quite a lot of weight compared to the display version, almost three times as much. But the actual stem weight, so the vertical strokes, have been reduced in weight, primarily taken out from the inside, so we can increase the counter space, the inside space of the letter form, to maintain a good solid white. And generally, some of the proportions have changed in the letter form as well. Now, just going back the slide again, when we look at the three variants from one another, particularly the super small size, almost looks like a completely different typeface altogether. And I would agree with that, you know, looking at this particular size. However, when you actually start looking at them in their respective sizes, you can see that they actually look exactly the same to one another. You know, you can see it is one and the same typeface. Right. Now, requirements. Before we actually take a project in hand, before we even think about the design and the aesthetics or anything, we want to know what are the requirements. We want to know where is this going to end up. And all the time we see this designers, because of a fashion trend or something like that, they tend to use light typefaces in a digital environment. That simply doesn't work, and we know that because Apple has tried it and has miserably failed with their Helvetica Lite in one of their most recent OS X updates. People can't read it. You know, I'm a 52-year-old person. I need stuff large, and I need it dark. I can't read it otherwise. This is important. You know, understand the requirements, and then you can design for it. So that means you need to understand, where is it going to go? I mean, for example, here, Adobe, Apple, FreeTap, Microsoft, what do all these have in common? It's a rasterizer. The rasters, every single one of those platforms uses a rasterizer that converts your font outlines into pixels, but they do it all in a different way. So you need to understand where your font is going to be, in what environment, and you need to understand the behavior of the font on that specific rasterizer so that you can predict the outcome on the screen, and therefore you can design for that outcome. That means, you know, you have to make certain changes. It could be that your requirement is very narrow, that you design for a specific device only. But more often than not, you design for something where you have very little control over. You know? But rasterizers are important, and websites are important today as well. This is unfortunately a very poor image, but it acts as an illustration. When you look at a typeface on a web browser, you can have a typeface on a computer looking at it in different web browsers on that same computer, on the same rasterizer, and in every single browser, that font will look different. And this is controlled by the browser. And I, as a font designer, have absolutely no control over how my font behaves in this environment. None whatsoever. Yet the problem is that users and font and web developers always come back to me and complain about the font display quality, which I think is a little bit unfair, considering, you know, that I have no control over it at all, you know, when it really should be up to the browser developers and to the rasterizer developers to finally come up with a standard and everyone work to the same standard so we have a coherent display of typefaces in a screen environment. But that's a different discussion altogether. But again, it is about understanding the requirements. And once you understand the requirements, you can work to the lowest common denominator to guarantee at least a quality of screen display. There will be variations of that quality, but it will be a quality, and eventually people will get used to that as well. Again, whether that is good or bad, that's a different conversation. So, besides all the various software types, you of course have different hardware types, different resolutions, different way of showing it, different ratios, etc., etc. You need to understand that as well. Just a simple fact, for example, that different mobile phones have different technical requirements to the typeface, for example, in their vertical bounding box, is something you need to understand when you create fonts for a digital environment, but also when you use fonts in a digital environment, because it has an impact on the languages that you can potentially support or not. But I'll come to that in a little while. Now, rasterizers. What we see here is a character in a clear type view with a vertical hinting applied. Now, clear type obviously accesses the sub-pixel in every pixel, and generally, as a generalization, you can say that the division of the sub-pixels usually goes horizontal. So by addressing the sub-pixel, in effect, I'm tripling the resolution of the screen, getting a much better and a much more accurate display of the typeface on the screen. However, in the vertical direction, I still have the full pixel, and this is what I need to control with hinting. Hinting today, despite the high resolutions that are available, is still as necessary as it was 10, 15 years ago, simply because of the fact that you have to have the vertical pixel control. If you don't do that, you get uneven displays, for example, of X heights, of cap heights, and so on and so forth, potentially even breaking up of characters altogether. Yeah. So hinting is still necessary today. And again, going back to the idea of the requirements, going and understanding the devices it is used on, not every device is high resolution, not every device is potentially LCD either. So hinting is still necessary today. Now, there is various ways of hinting. So on the left, we see a vertical hinting only, where the outline is forced to fall onto the pixel grid, allowing me to control the placement of the pixel and allowing me to make sure that the line shows nice and dark. On the right, we're breaking off one part of the forcing onto the pixel grid. So we're controlling the base heights, for example, the X height, and we're controlling the baseline, and they sit exactly on the pixel grid. But in the inside, we're letting it go. Now, this gives me some sort of font smoothing, and in some environments, this may actually be desirable. But in other environments, this can lead to some unpleasant effects, potentially like we see here, where we have a dropout of a pixel altogether at the top part of the A, where we have a white gap, as well as on the inside, where we have a white gap, and this will result in a jaggy look of the character. So this may not be desirable, so it has to be tested to the target devices that you're planning to use. We may also want to include horizontal hinting, and that is necessary because nowadays devices obviously get turned from, say, landscape to portrait. And as you turn your device, then of course your pixel direction changes. So what used to be a horizontal sub-pixeling effect immediately becomes a vertical sub-pixeling effect. So therefore, your typeface, your hinted font, needs to be able to respond to that by then using the horizontal hinting to fix your outlines onto the pixel grid, thus guaranteeing a good screen display result. And horizontal hinting is, of course, necessary when you go back into a black and white environment. Low resolution, legacy devices, etc., etc. If you don't do that, you're going to have very poor display quality. And by having horizontal and vertical hinting in a black environment, in an anti-aliased environment here, you can guarantee a good quality of screen display, not necessarily aesthetic, but highly legible. Again, you may want to decide, depending on the target devices and target resolutions, you may want to decide to change your hinting strategy slightly by breaking off parts, breaking them off the pixel grid in order to get a bit more font smoothing. But this would be a very targeted hinting strategy for specific devices. This is, for example, a hinting strategy that we had to apply for the fonts, excuse me, for the fonts we did for Nokia for a specific devices, where we had to create a whole suite of fonts with their own hinting, as you can see here on the left. All the other fonts had a hinting more applied, as you can see on the right. And then black and white, pure black and white does require hinting. You can't get around it. It's absolutely necessary so you can show the character in a legible format. If you don't apply hinting, this is what you're going to get. It's as simple as that. You need to do it. And hinting is, of course, still necessary because despite the fact that everyone is talking about super high resolutions and smartphones and Nexus this and Kindle that, there is still environments where we're working on very low resolutions, 12 pixels per m square maybe, and I am thinking of public signage or electronic signage, for example, bus stations, train stations, and so on, where you only have a limited amount of pixels available. It's a black and white environment, pixel on, pixel off, that's it. You need hinting for those environments to make sure that your typeface and your letter forms perform exactly the way you intend to do. So, we're also talking about resolutions. What we see here on the left is a character at 13 point in a 96 dpi resolution. So that equates to roughly about 17 pixels per m. And as you can see, I'm employing the vertical hinting only, and the character looks pretty good, and you know, it's legible and everything, and a certain amount of aesthetics are incorporated as well. Of course, as we go up in the resolution, and here, if I'm not mistaken, we have 212 dpi resolution, the hinting still applies. It still allows me to control the placement of the characters, of the pixels, making sure that my stem widths are even and that I haven't got any nasty surprises, but already I have enough resolution to show the aesthetics of the typeface. Going up in resolution still to about 252 pixels, obviously I have more flexibility in what I can do. You can, for example, see that the overshoot is now happening. That means where you have the curve of the bowl at the baseline, it starts dropping below the straight line. At the lower resolutions, this would have quite a horrendous effect in being way too obvious, but just having this 40 extra pixels resolution gives me enough definition to make that overshoot not look too obvious, you know, but actually typographically more what it is intended to be. And then going up really high resolution to around 360 dpi, I'm having plenty of pixels available to actually show this typeface in all its glorious detail. And nowadays, we're already talking about, I think, with the latest Retina displays, resolutions over 400 dpi. So to a degree, for those particular environments and for those particular targets, hinting isn't necessary anymore. But I would always advise to apply some hinting, because you will end up with the typeface being used in a legacy environment. As a type user, today in the digital world, you cannot control where your fonts are going to end up. And don't forget, high resolutions, smartphones, and all that stuff is happening at the moment only here in Europe and in the Western and developed world. There is still large parts of the planet and large groups of users that do not have access to this type of technology, yet they need access to high quality typography. Just talking a little bit, since we're talking about high resolutions, although that I'd just like to introduce you to a little project we recently finished with Amazon, and we designed the new user interface typeface for the Kindle Fire HD7, and this typeface will eventually also be rolled out on future Amazon devices. So it's a UI typeface sans serif, and you can pretty much see on the screen the various briefing requirements that were necessary. Now, the beauty about designing for this particular typeface was that the target devices and the target resolutions were fairly clearly defined at the moment or at the point of designing the typeface. It was for this particular environment, plus give or take an extra couple usages too, but not an unknown quantity. It was a very known quantity where this typeface was going to be used. Now, in the process of designing, so we understand all the requirement. Once with the understanding of the requirement, we started sketching. And when we sketch at Dalton Mark, the first things is always a few pencil drawings, trying to get an idea of the look and feel of the typeface, of the detailing, and how that could play with. And you could argue, well, you can do that on the screen, but maybe I'm a Luddite, but I believe actually with the pencil, it's really nice. You can do it in a few seconds. You can capture a shape, you can capture a form, you can capture an idea, and instantly make a judgment as to whether that shape or form actually will perform or not. But once with those ideas captured, we then put a few sample characters onto the screen, drew up the characters in font format, and the four concepts, as you can see now on the screen, the four concepts were then sent to the client for testing and for basically choosing one design concept to go forward. Eventually, the client chose one design, had some comments, and we improved on the design concept and started expanding the character set. Of course, here this printout has loads of markups and correction points and everything. But one of the things you have to understand is that in this particular instance, because it's a UI font, we always tested and judged the performance of the typeface on the screen, on the actual device, and not on paper, because it makes no sense to look at the typeface on paper when it's actually used on the screen. The paper printout merely served to make sure that we could annotate the changes that we were planning to do. In the design process, because we were to design a light, a regular, and a bold, in the design process, we of course started with the light and the bold first to then electronically interpolate the regular weight. Now, in the whole design process, we also made sure that the light and the bold were designed in parallel. So once you design the light A, for example, you would then design the bold A. And this allows us consistency across the design and across the weights, but also digital consistency, meaning that all the digital points are exactly the same across every single characters across the two weights, even to the point where we're placing diacritic marks. Everything was done in parallel, side by side, character by character, to allow us a more efficient design and production process. Again, once the Latin and the italics were designed, we then moved on to Greek and Cyrillic, because the Kindle character set requires those three writing systems. And throughout the design process, always judging it on the screen in the actual environment. Here we go now. We have the bold Amazon Ember. And when you look at it in bold, and the screen here obviously does it no justice whatsoever, but the bold, even at the smaller sizes, looks fairly good. It looks legible, etc., etc. And you have to trust me on this now, because I have seen it on the screen. Yet when you reverse it out, the bold all of a sudden becomes blurry and quite unpleasant to read. And this is, of course, because you have the halo effect in the digital environment. So when we compare it then to the light at the other extreme, the light, black on white, is far too thin. It breaks up, and it just it just doesn't read well at all. However, if you put it into a reverse environment, the light all of a sudden becomes quite pleasant to read. So we also designed a regular, and unfortunately I haven't got the screenshots of the regular at the moment, but the regular is sort of like the compromise of the bold and the light, and it performs really well on a black on white, as well as in a reversed environment. So the legibility in both environments is guaranteed, and it really works well. In the digital world, particularly in UI, you have this situation where you always have to switch from positive to negative. And this is a requirement that you have to take into account when you design a typeface for digital, or when you choose a typeface for digital. You have to be aware of this switch. You have to be aware of the halo effect. You have to be aware of the halo effect on the spacing of the characters. You may need to space it out a little bit, because otherwise the characters blur together. Things like that. This is the sort of like detail you need to understand. Here we just got a couple pictures of the font in usage now. And eventually we also designed a thin additional. The thin is only used in quite large sizes on the screen, and for advertisement purposes, but it's only used at very large sizes, because as you can see in the smaller sizes on the screen, it simply wouldn't perform at all, you know, with characters breaking up, and despite the hinting, characters breaking up potentially, and just being too light. It's not useful for a continuous reading environment. So consistency. Consistency matters. Consistency matters particularly in design, but also when you go across languages. Today, with digital, we cannot look at Latin only. Of course, Latin covers probably about a third of the world's population, or about a third of the world's population uses the Latin script natively. But the rest of the world uses their own writing systems. And if you look at this map, you can find that the vast majority of the writing systems are geographically concentrated into a fairly small area in Asia. India alone has 11 official writing systems. India alone, with its 1.3 billion people, has over 500 distinct languages. Thousands of dialects, I say, represented by 11 writing systems. How on earth are you going to deal with that? You have to understand that when you work for it in a digital environment, that you need to be able to serve those environments. And once you start going away from the Latin and the Greek and the Cyrillic writing systems, things become complicated, very complicated indeed. But let me just talk a little bit about consistency, because it doesn't only work for typefaces. Some years ago, we worked on the design of the Vodafone logo, and then eventually did the typeface for them as well. But one of the requirements was that Vodafone logo would also be translated or transliterated visually into different writing systems, the ones that you can see here. So that's Greek, Cyrillic, Armenian, Arabic, Devanagari, Thai, and then I think it was Malayalam and Telugu, if I'm not mistaken, both Chinese, Japanese, and Korean. Those are the markets. And in many of these markets around the world, a company cannot simply go in and say, hey, we're a Western company, we do everything in English or everything in Latin characters. It will not be expected. People do expect to be communicated to in their own language, in their own writing systems. And therefore, it is important that a brand is consistent in its visual approach to that logo in different writing systems. This is absolutely important. And this is something, as a digital designer and as a digital typographer, you have to understand and you have to acknowledge and you have to be, it's a requirement that you have to work toward. We did the same for Intel Clear. Now, Intel Clear comes in Latin, Greek, and Cyrillic, Arabic, and Hebrew, Devanagari, and Chinese. And when you design a typeface, a multi-script typeface, normally you start off with the Latin typeface. That's because that's the first requirement. Everyone communicates in English, so therefore the Latin has to be done. And you conceptualize with the Latin, but that is a fallacy. Nowadays, when you in a digital world, in a global world, if you design a multi-script typeface, or even if you choose a multi-script typeface, you need to choose them and design them all at the same time. You need to understand, or at least conceptualize them at the same time. You need to understand how they function together. And one of the major things is, how are they sitting together proportionally? That means that really you should start designing with the Chinese, because the Chinese sitting in a square obviously defines the overall size of the typeface. So you have your Chinese characters, and then you need to set your Latin against the Chinese, and you need to size the Latin characters so they sit comfortably next to the Chinese. Once you have established those proportions, you then need to think about the other script and how do you sit them against the Latin. Once they sit fine against the Latin, they will sit fine against the Chinese, and they will sit fine against one another. The big problem is that in many of the Asian typefaces, the Southeast Asian ones, the Indic ones, they tend to be really tall characters. Like here in the Devanagari, you can see they have a like really deep descender. Or if you go into the Arabic, as in the bottom example, and I don't think this word actually, that the letter combination means anything. It's a random letter combination simply to illustrate the massive extent of the ascenders, or the highest point and the lowest point in the font, to show you the effect this can have on your typesetting and the effect this could potentially have in your digital environment. So now imagine the Arabic with its really tall characters, and you have to typeset that in a annual report where on one page you have the Arabic and on the other page you have the Latin. You will have to make a decision if you want to keep a baseline grid across both pages. You have to make the decision to either have really large leading for the Latin characters, or really small characters for the Arabic, in order to fit those heights to one another. But if I design a typeface and I conceptualize all the scripts right from the start together, I can make design decisions in the typeface to minimize the effects of this overall height, and therefore ensure that the user of the typeface has less problems dealing with the typeface and the implementation of the typeface. There's another reason that the effects of really tall characters has to be minimized, and that is that many devices, particularly mobile phones, still have a physical limitation in regards to their bounding box, basically their highest and lowest point a font or a character can sit in. If the character exceeds that bounding box, they will simply be cropped, and obviously that is a loss of quality, potentially affects legibility as well. So it is absolutely crucial to conceptualize all the scripts right from the start. And as a digital designer, and generally as a brand designer, when you talk to a client and you have a good feeling that they actually want to communicate globally, you need to make them understand they need to do this from the start. They cannot just bolt on bits and pieces later. It will fail. They need to understand that this has to be done all at the same time. Chinese. If a Chinese font is distributed in the People's Republic of China, it has to adhere to the standard GB18030. Now, this standard stipulates that the font has to have around 27,500 characters. These characters are given to the font developer by the Chinese government. There's a clear standard and you have to follow it if you want to have the font distributed within the People's Republic. 27,500 characters, a huge amount of work. The font also has to be then certified by the Chinese government at great expense, I might add. And only once a certification has happened,
Hello, Bruno. Are you there? Hello? Hello?
That's also for the embedding in and 3 to 3.5 megabytes. But how do you do that with 27? Now, fortunately, the Chinese writing system is highly structured and highly systemized. In essence, a Chinese character is made up of about 10 to 12 calligraphic strokes. In different proportions and different sizes, so you can place them anywhere in the word symbol where they need to be. Chinese consists of roughly around 300 radical characters, which are then put together to form a larger, to then create a table of individual elements which can be recycled over and over again. And if I go back into the previous slide, we can see that the character we see here actually doesn't exist as a character. These are all recycled elements out of the table, and they're simply referenced. In this particular character, it just says, hey, pick me up this element, and that element, and draw it on the screen. So there is no data for this character, or only very minimal data. All the data sits in this element table of about 15,000 or so elements for the Intel typeface. These are being recycled time and again, and with this method, I can reduce the size of the characters to the size of the font to roughly about 3 to 3.5 megabytes.
Okay.
There should be more. Hang on a sec. Yeah. Here we go. The user matters. Now, we do still have some time, Dave?
Yeah, absolutely. I want to get back to the plankton.
Oh, yeah. We come back to the plankton soon. We come to, you know, we still have the user to go as well, I'm afraid.
Okay.
You know?
That's good.
yeah, the user. Now, also as part of the requirements, the user, you have to start thinking of the users when you design typefaces, when you use fonts, and when you design for digital. Now, just looking at this, I did a little study, a very brief study, about the aging population in the various parts of the world. And you can see that in 2014, the majority of the population is basically between 40 and 55 years old. That's where it's sort of like most bulging. This is my age group. That means physiologically we're starting to fall apart, our eyesight is going, and so on and so forth. But it also means economically that we are the age group with the most spending power. Now, if you're designing, you have to design mine. Unfortunately, for all you young, you know, move, you can see who you're going to be, like me, for example. So I have to be very nice to you, so we can keep paying my pension for the future. But move that back down into India, and you can see the vast majority of the population is anywhere between, you know, 1 and 25 years old, and it's a very small part that is older. So that it means it's completely different design requirements. In China, it's a bit weird one there, but I guess we can see some of the effects, you know, of the single child policy and so on. And the United States seems to be a fairly monolithic block there. But you need to understand who your users are. So some time ago, some years ago, we designed the typefaces for BMW's internal navigation system, so for the maps, the GPS navigation system, but also for the internal entertainment system in the cars. And the requirement was to design it with legibility, for the legibility of a 55-year-old user in mind. The 55-year-old male is BMW's target group. So therefore, the legibility has to be tweaked in such a way that my age group, we can read this very quickly. And don't forget, on the German Autobahn, these people drive at 250 kilometers an hour. So you do not have very a lot of time to actually look at the screen and instantly be able to recognize what the words is. Very important. So understand the user, then you can design for it. Right, reading. Want to do a little bit of science, just briefly, and just sort of like to understand how we're actually reading, because it has an effect as well. Now, when you read something or you have an image, it comes into your eyes, it hits the back of your retina, and then it travels along your optic nerve to the way back of your brain into the visual cortex. Now, that image then from the visual cortex gets distributed across your brain, primarily into areas that deal with where, who, and what. Now, those three areas are being to navigate in space, to recognize faces, to communicate, simply to exist, in essence. But there is also an area that gets activated when letter forms are involved, and that is the visual word form area, which is dotted in red. It sits on the left hemisphere, just around behind and at the upper part of the ear. And every single character on this planet, whatever the writing system, whatever the language, gets processed in there. From there, so the visual word form area first processes the characters, then puts two characters together and starts recognizing the shape of two, three, or four characters, and then recognizing a word shape. And once it has a word, it sends that out into other parts of the area to then process semantics and eventually language as well. So, but the important part of the visual word form area is that it does not care what font style this is in. The visual word form area only wants to know, do I recognize the letter form or not? So in the example here that we have in this very blurred image, if you remember, if you see the previous one here, the very blurred image, the bottom one is obviously a black letter type, and the individual characters become quite ambiguous and you can't read them anymore. And this means now that either the legibility is highly compromised or that the visual word form area, because it doesn't recognize the letter form so well anymore because we're not used to reading black letter type, it simply doesn't activate it and it more or less ignores what it says. Two samples, Arial and Times New Roman, we can see a fairly high recognition still. The skeleton of the shapes is still there. We can still see the letter forms. So therefore, we have a high activation of the visual or word form area, and we can read the letters. Now, it is now debatable whether Arial reads better than Times New Roman. In terms of legibility, I would suggest that Arial has maybe a lower legibility simply because there is more ambiguity in the letter forms than in Times New Roman. It would be worth testing it. This is also something to understand when you choose typefaces or when you design typefaces for any type of branding, for any type of usages, particularly in the digital environment. We're looking at three sans serif typefaces. We have at the top, we have obviously Arial. The second version is the typeface Ember for Amazon. And at the bottom, we have a typeface we designed for Manchester Metrolink for signage purposes. So you can see the first one is a grotesque style typeface, whereas the other two are more humanist designs. And if you blur that again, I would suggest that the humanist designs have a better legibility simply because the character forms are less ambiguous than they are in Arial. Now, responsive. Everyone is doing responsive websites nowadays, and it is necessary because we simply have so many different environments where digital content has to be created on. And I would suggest that the future of typefaces is responsive too. We're not quite there yet, but it has to go that way. That, for example, like you look at a website. In a website, you may want to have a typeface, a display of a typeface, which is a little bit wider, maybe sort of like the example that you see, the third line down on the fourth column from the left. That would be a nice typeface on a website, so it's generously spaced, it has a generous width, it has a nice generous weight as well. Because you can do that on a website where you read it on, a laptop or on a large screen. You have the space. You can be generous. However, the moment you go onto a mobile phone, however large the resolution is, space becomes a premium. You would then want the typeface to be responding to that and say, okay, I want a more condensed typeface so I can ensure a higher letter count per line. And you may want to have a typeface, the typeface responding to that with a design that is more like the second from the top and the second from the left. So more condensed, more compact, more information in that. So this is really where the future of type design should go, in my opinion. And I think it will go into that direction where we have responsive typefaces, not only responsive design as a whole. You know. So branding matters. Branding matters. There was something I'm going to say about branding matters, and I had totally lost the thread now on this one. I can't remember what I was going to say about branding matters, so I have to apologize for this. But I've lost it completely.
That's all right. I mean, I guess you do a lot of branding work. You know, type design for branding identities.
Indeed. Yeah, there was a point I was going to make, but I can't remember it, I'm afraid. So I do apologize for that. But in the whole part is expectation management. Expectation management of the client, expectation management of the end user. Only once those expectations are managed, be that in the way the typeface performs, in the way the typeface displays, in the way an animation performs, only once you manage those expectations, you will know that your typeface can be a success, that your project can be a success. So whatever you do, whenever you work, make sure your client understands exactly what they get and that there is actually only so much you can do. So now, coming back to the plankton. So plankton, as we saw at the very beginning, is of course absolutely crucial to the well-being of this planet. You know, without plankton, there is no fish. Without fish, there is no human beings. Nothing will exist anymore. And it's only once something is missing or something doesn't work well anymore that we actually understand the importance of it. Plankton is simply there. We don't even think about plankton. Most people don't even know what plankton is. But if you remove it, the consequence of it will be tragic. The same goes with typeface. Every day we consume typefaces, and generally the typefaces work. So you don't even see them, you just consume them, they function, they work, and you communicate, everything is happy. The moment something doesn't work anymore with the font, you notice and you get angry and you can't communicate. So therefore, it is absolutely crucial that we make sure that plankton survives, but we also make sure that we take care of our typefaces and of our typography. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Bruno. Yeah, no, I think that's an excellent kind of metaphor and way of framing the issue.
So I hope this has been informative. I hope this has been informative for you guys.
I think it's really nice to have this kind of introduction to what clients need out of typeface projects, some of the details, the way that the branding, the technology, the visual design all come together.
Yeah. Good. Excellent. I think I have disappeared from the screen, haven't I?
No,
it's true. I'm just being really dark, you know, because I'm in a room, I'm sitting in a room without light, you know,
oh.
And in London it's pitch black now.
Okay, I'm sorry about that. All right, well, thanks so much. So your website is daltonmaag.com, and
thank you.
Encourage people to check it out. You've just launched a new site. It's very nice.
Yes, it's indeed. And you can download all our phones fully functional as a trial version. You know, so please go ahead. You know.
Great. Okay.
Cool. Okay
thanks,
then.
Bruno.
All right. Cheers.
Yeah.
Bye-bye.